So I will present a bit about the project that I've been researching on within Samspel, which is called Smart and Robust Energy Infrastructure for the Future. Just a little bit by means of introduction, the project itself aims to identify and address the future capacity requirements in the Stockholm region as a result of all the different distributed energy resources that we know are happening as a trend, so increased electric vehicle use, digitalization in general, heat pump installation, and big data halls, for example. So we know these are that in the future there's going to be more electric cars and more heat pumps expected in the grid. So the idea is to build from bottom up, analyze the need for production capacity within the Stockholm region, and how could today's distribution network manage these new loads? To what extent demand-side management can take us a bit further before having to install the whole new power plant in the Stockholm region? With the focus of those capacity limitations until 2030. And of course, this project would not be possible without the collaboration of Ellevio, who is the district distribution system operator. So since February 2012, we've settled a collaboration in order to look at these things with them. The background to this study, I mean, there's many similar studies, of course, but the inspiration was a similar study done in Gothenburg by David Sten, which looked at the impact of in the distribution system due to plugging electric vehicles. And so, I mean, as a main outcome of this study, you can see in the figure simply the charging profile of electric vehicles for three different strategies, one of them being the uncontrolled, so you see the peak towards the afternoon. The other one, when you're loss optimal, so you see that one more yemt, like more equal during the day. But then, for example, you see something, I mean, it's very well said that we can charge at the times where the prices are low, for example, but that can very much generate simply the same problem or peaks just at a different time where we don't want them. But since you can increase the penetration of electric vehicles, but to a certain extent in which you will simply just create new peaks. So with this as inspiration, we set ourselves goals for this project. So applicable to Stockholm, first and foremost, do a scenario constructions from national trends from the next coming 5 and 25 years. Secondly, which is, I would say, the goal in which we're focusing or a lot of the energy in, it's really goals 2 and 3, it's really building power flow models of different parts of the network and assessing technically via models what these loads are affecting the cables and the transformers in the different stations. And then finally, goal 4 would be, after doing these separate studies for districts in Stockholm, going bottom up to say, okay, if we were managed to model a percentage of the load in the Stockholm grid, we can say that this translates to the whole Stockholm demand in this way. And what it would be really needed is this many megawatts in order to clear ourselves in this gap until 2030, in which Sweco can finally build or give more effect. Or even maybe in the way find out that we can just do it with demand side management alone. And then finally, what would be that technology that just can step in to just cover these capacity needs, techno-economically speaking? So of course, in terms of goal 1, this is a lot of like gathering data from different studies, like the NEP, for example, or other studies that have done scenarios. So here you have a very well-known picture, which is the one to the far right, with in gray is the megawatts that are entering the Stockholm region via Sweco, and in yellow is what Stockholm Exergi produces internally. And then the black line is the projection of how Stockholm's region is expected to increase. And well, there we see a very scary triangle in which it would seem that we will have some blackouts. And of course, we also have the well-known trends of heat pumps seeming or appearing to be a good choice as a change, because it depends on our already clean electricity. And BRFs in certain parts on Stockholm, like for example in Hammarby Sjöstad, they see it profitable for their electricity bills to switch to heat pumps. But without knowing that this might just bring the problem on the other side of the grid. this is like the bottom-up way of building scenarios. But of course, we also have in the bottom, I just put the new draft of Miljöförvaltningen for the Stockholm region. Like we see how the carbon emissions for Stockholm have been decreasing. But one that kind of has stayed the same over the years is the ones from transport. So this also leads us to think that even though whether the electric vehicle is just a trend and let's leave it up to the market, maybe it's even good to actually force this to happen and be prepared in the grid for this to happen, because this will decrease the emissions coming from transport. And the green line in the pie chart is how much emissions come from personal vehicles, for example. So it can be, scenarios can be technically driven, or it can also be policy driven in the way we test it with the network. And essentially, with regards to goal two, we've looked at different parts of Stockholm. I just want to highlight Hammarby, Sjöstad and Lidingö with a little bit of the sketch of the map and the sketch of their network, just to do analysis of the sort once we build the network hand in hand with Ellevio. Looking at, for example, for Hammarby, Sjöstad, the bar chart here shows 5 critically loaded days. And if we go to the extremes and say, of what is the base loads of those days, how much could we fit in the remaining effect if everybody connects at the same time? And you see on the right the number of vehicles that could be connected at the same time, or the number of heat pumps that could be connected at the same time in those critically loaded hours. But of course, this helps us quantify or have like an Armageddon case, like if everybody really does it at the same time. But of course, looking more into behavioral questions, and this is the case of Lidingö, in which in blue you have the base loads, but then what you come is the peak generated by electric vehicles of people in a distributed way by statistics come home and they charge their vehicles at the same time. And of course, this creates different loadings in the cables of that network and also in the transformer. So we try to see or already assess for the DSO, which parts of their network are already looking critical already now, which would mean if the trend continues, they would be critical in the future. Of course, the comparison of this scenario in which everybody connects at the same time, you can see it in the far left, and I still call it the Armageddon one. This is the whole or the number of vehicles total that could connect at the same time and the effect that they generate in gray. But we can see that when we consider different scenarios for distributed arrival of cars and charging at home, you can of course connect much more vehicles because they will just overlap, or they will not create one sole peak, but there's this Zaman-Lagnitz effect. So we try for different level of penetrations of electric vehicles. We would try for projections of different base loads. And of course the idea is then to include different management strategies around tariffs that could steer these loads in a different way, or actually just some active control to charge the vehicles when it's more convenient. In parallel to this, we've been doing in the low voltage network, so zooming in really, and this is even more behavioral aspects, like when you connect a heat pump, it not only affects the electricity grid, but it has this whole idea that, like the picture on top, the black solid line will be the way that a heat pump will follow the heat load. But if you actually decide to operate that heat pump in a different way, like you generate much more heat before the peak because you count that the buildings have a thermal capacity, then you are improving the network. However, there will be the question of the comfort temperature that we all have, whether this is feasible or not. So in reality, it's not a question of only one energy vector. We kind of need to look at sector coupling in order to understand what is better for the grid. And in terms of future steps, I don't know what this sound is. In terms of future steps, of course, I mean, I call this future, but this is actually my present a bit. Load management strategies around these distributed energy resources, or also looking at more grid-related questions, which is, there's a way of sizing the grid, which is stated on Velander's constants, which is a ratio of energy to power, which is no longer applicable when you have electric vehicles, which generate a very big peak, so lots of power, but this relationship to energy is no longer maintained. So maybe it's good advice for the DSOs to have a look at this this new relationship between power and energy that a resource like electric vehicles is giving us. And well, then eventually the ultimate goal of this project is to build up on this, to kind of address or be able to assess both to, for example, Stockholm Exergis, Stockholm Stad, and Ellevio in their conversations to say, well, you don't need to install a whole new power plant and maybe put this price on the customers on the end, like who takes the price of these new investments. And yeah, with that, for the workshop, feel free to ask me questions now or later. But I would like just to leave with a message, just the same of the question as Johanna put at the beginning, but that not only to focus it on the electricity vector, but also think that different sectors can support each other reach this robustness that we are after. Yeah, thank you.